Remember when our parents used to tell us that video games would rot our brains? Well, turns out they were wrong about that. Video games won't rot your brain, and in some cases, it can actually be beneficial to play them. However, if your particular set of parental units happen to use the term warp your brain, well, then they might have been on the right track. In the last few decades, brain scientists have learned a lot about something called neuroplasticity. Essentially, the brain changes its physical configuration in response to the tasks you give it and the stimuli you expose it to. This can include something as simple as using a clock to something as complex as playing a video game, and it can also include using the internet. Over the past few years, I've had this sneaking suspicion that my daily internet use was having subtle effects on the way that I think. I used to be able to sit and immerse myself in a book for hours, but now that task is a lot harder. I often daydream or get caught being distracted. And I seem to remember being bored a lot when I was a kid, but now boredom almost never creeps into my life. There's always something grabbing for my attention. And it turns out that this suspicion wasn't misplaced. Like the clock and the video game and countless other technologies, the internet quietly changes the structure of our brains as we use it, and not always in ways that are positive. The brain's process of rewiring itself works a bit like taping over a VHS tape. As the psychiatrist Norman Doidge puts it, if we stop exercising our mental skills, we do not just forget them. The brain map space for those skills,
such as deep book reading,
is turned over to the skills we practice instead,
such as browsing endless pages of the dankest memes.
So today, let's explore just how the internet affects our brains, and how we can prevent, or at least reverse, its most harmful changes. In the late 1800s, the philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche's eyesight began to fail him, and this brought with it a terrible consequence. It made it almost impossible for him to write. The act of focusing his eyes on a page gave him terrible headaches, and he worried that he would have to give up the practice altogether. But something saved him, and that something was called the Mollinghansen writing ball. Now, as weird as this thing looks, it was actually the fastest typewriter ever built back when it was released, and it also saved Nietzsche's writing career. Once he learned to touch type with it, he could write once more, albeit now with his eyes closed. The writing ball didn't just rescue Nietzsche's ability to write, though. It also changed the character of his output. One of his close friends at the time noted that Nietzsche's writing took on a new forcefulness, that it became tighter, and Nietzsche himself agreed, writing, "You are right. Our writing equipment takes part in the forming of our thoughts." And it's not just our writing equipment that does this. In the book, The Shallows, What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains, which was actually the primary source for this video, the author Nicholas Carr demonstrates how nearly all the technology we use can cause real physical changes within our brains. For example, one experiment that was done on violin players showed that the area of their sensory cortexes that controlled their fingering hands was actually much larger than that of a control group who had never played a musical instrument before. But it's not just the physical use of tools that can cause these changes. Even purely mental activity. And Tony, can you like make a hammer float here in the air with, you know, your editing skills? All right, let's try it again. Even purely mental activity shaped by technology can do the same thing. Another experiment done on London cab drivers found that compared to a control group, the area of the driver's brains called the posterior hippocampus was much larger than normal. And as you might expect, this is an area of the brain that plays a huge part in helping us understand our physical surroundings. Now, you wouldn't be wrong to point out that it's no big surprise a cab driver's brain would adapt to the task of navigating a complex web of city streets when that's what they spend all day long doing. But other technologies have far subtler and further reaching effects. Before the invention of the clock, people perceive time in a very different way than we do today. To them, time flowed like a stream of water, and the transition from one moment to the next was seamless and imperceptible. Once we started tracking time, though, that all changed. When we invented the first timekeeping devices, we changed our conception of time itself. Instead of being an unbroken stream, time became a series of discrete, individual units, and as clocks became more and more accurate, those units got smaller and more precise. Suddenly, we were thinking in terms of hours, and then minutes, and eventually seconds. And we also became fixated on productivity. How much time did we spend? How much time have we wasted?
Look at the time!
But there was a larger effect as well. Once we started looking at time as a construct made up of small parts, that thinking got extended to everything else. As Carr writes, once the clock had redefined time as a series of units of equal duration, our minds began to stress the methodical mental work of division and measurement. We began to see in all things and phenomena the pieces that composed the whole. The clock's methodical ticking helped bring into being the scientific mind and the scientific man. And if the clock made a big change to the way that we think, then writing made an even bigger one. Now, this technology took thousands of years to progress through the necessary stages. The shift from logographic characters to phonetic alphabets, the addition of spacing between words, and the invention of the Gutenberg press, just to name a few. But eventually, this technology caused huge shifts in our behavior. Once the general population became literate, they started to read.
What you reading for?
And not just that, they started to read silently for long periods of time. And this is a bigger deal than you might think. Carr writes, to read a book was to practice an unnatural process of thought, one that demanded sustained, unbroken attention to a single static object. And for people to do this, they had to forge neural pathways that would allow them to apply top-down control over their attention. Top-down control is something that has to be learned and practiced. Naturally, we're wired for bottom-up attention. Our senses are finely tuned to pick up changes in our environment, and our attention naturally drifts to them. It's constantly shifting. Now, this is great for noticing a lurking tiger or a potential source of food, but it's not so great for deep analytical reading. It just doesn't allow for that type of prolonged, intense concentration that's necessary for parsing complex ideas. And through the act of reading, we developed a new type of attentional control, one that was far better suited to that task. But now it seems like we're starting to lose that ability. So let's revisit that experiment with the London cab drivers again for a second, because there's something that I didn't mention. In addition to the enlargement of the posterior hippocampus, the researchers also found a change in the anterior hippocampus. It shrank. And in further tests, they found that that shrinking may have actually harmed the cab driver's ability to perform on other memorization tasks. Norman Doidge's words come back to mind here. When we stop using a certain skill, the neural pathways that used to support it get reconfigured to enhance the skills that we do use. As the psychiatrist Jeffrey Swartz puts it, it's survival of the busiest. And I'm sure you can see where this is going. Unless, of course, you've already gotten distracted and clicked away from this video, which just makes you an example of my next point. The technology that we now spend most of our time using, the internet, definitely doesn't do anything to encourage the use of the neural pathways that are devoted to top-down attentional control and long-term concentration on a single source. As Carr puts it, our use of the internet involves many paradoxes, but the one that promises to have the greatest long-term influence over how we think is this one. The net seizes our attention only to scatter it. In other words, the internet promotes distractedness and multitasking. At almost all times, we are surrounded by multiple internet-connected devices. And even on a single computer, you can be watching a video, have 18 different tabs open at the same time, be playing Spotify in the background, and be getting messages on iMessage and Slack at the same time. Oh, and also playing Overwatch in the other monitor, can't forget about that one. Moreover, the internet rewards this type of distracted behavior. It's not just our frequent use of this technology that gives it such a powerful ability to shape our neural pathways. It's also the fact that it offers constant, quick dopamine hits. It constantly stimulates the reward loop inside our heads. The result is that the internet promotes the return to our natural, bottom-up state of attentional control. There's always something new happening, somewhere else to shift your focus. And just like with those London cab drivers, your brain has to give something up. The more time you allow the internet to promote this distracted, frenzied style of consuming information, the less time you spend deeply concentrated on singular tasks. And as a result, the less able you are to call up that deep concentration when you really need it. So, what can we do about this? Are we just stuck in a downward spiral, doomed to end up like the people in Idiocracy?
Because Brown's got electrolytes.
Or can we reverse this trend? Where have you been, Barty? Said Bagman. Why weren't you at the match? Your elf was saving you a seat too, gulping gargoyles. Oh, there's more of the video. I thought we were done. Okay, I guess we're at the part of the video where I give you 10 ideas for reclaiming your attention. Yeah, I did write that part in the script. Okay, before we get into this, remember, it is survival of the busiest. The key isn't to just stop using the internet, which is, as it turns out, a pretty useful invention. Instead, it's to reduce the activities that cause the undesirable changes and to replace them with activities that promote the neurological changes that you actually want to see. And this could mean that you don't even have to reduce the amount of time you spend on the internet at all. After all, there's plenty of long-form content on the internet. There's long articles, there's long video essays like this one, and plenty of other deep content. Plus, with apps like like Kindle Cloud Reader and projects like the Gutenberg Press, you can literally read millions of books from any internet-connected device. But there is a caveat here. Remember, the brain seeks out rewards, and that the internet tends to dole out the ones that promote distracted thinking. If you're reading a print book with your phone in the other room, it's pretty easy to resist the temptation to send a tweet or check your email, but it's a very different story if you're reading the exact same book on an internet-connected iPad. So we need to do two different things. Number one, promote the healthy activities that build that top-down attentional control. And number two, make some environmental changes that make it easier to shake our bad internet habits. So here are some ideas for mission number one to start. First, just read more books. And yeah, there's gonna be people out there who make the argument that books are full of filler, they're a waste of time, and you could get the same salient points by going over to Google and finding a well-written summary. But that argument isn't relevant right now, because in this case, the goal of reading a book is to promote deep, long-term concentration on one singular task. Second, spend time working without the internet. And yes, I know you feel like you need the internet, but honestly, a lot of my best research has come from finding books in the library. And if I'm being even more honest with myself, a lot of my work, especially writing once I have all my research material and video editing, doesn't require the internet at all. Now, my brain tells me that it does, but this is actually a sign that I've become dependent on the internet. And if anything, I should take it as a sign that I need to let that neural pattern fade a bit. Three, have more in-depth in-person conversations. Go out to dinner with your friends more often. And when you do, do not put your phone on the table. Keep it in your pocket or don't bring it at all. Four, watch more movies. And this has the exact same goal as reading books. You're paying attention to one piece of cinema for about 2 hours. And again, don't bring your phone into the experience. You don't need to live tweet Lord of the Rings. Finally, number five, commit to longer periods of time doing one thing. Go outside and ride your bike for a full hour or practice an instrument for 30 full minutes. Now, if you're like a lot of people, you probably feel too guilty to let yourself do these things because you feel like you have a lot of work to do. And if you're in that boat, I've got a suggestion for you. Install a program on your computer called Rescue Time. This will track the time that you spend on different apps and websites. And I bet after a few days of data gathering, you're gonna see that all your little trips to Twitter and Instagram and all your other little distracting websites actually add up to more time throughout the day than that hour you would have spent on the bike. And that just leaves us with mission number two, those environmental changes. And the first one is going to deal with, naturally, YouTube, since we are on YouTube right now. When you're watching videos on YouTube, watch them in full screen. Now, for almost my entire YouTube viewing life, I never did this. And it doesn't really make sense on the surface, right? Because if you put a video in full screen, it looks better. It takes up the entire monitor. But the reason becomes pretty clear once you understand neuroplasticity and our reward-seeking behavior and the way that YouTube is designed. Though I'm ostensibly watching the video I clicked on, part of my brain is also itching to click on something else that I see over in the sidebar. And going into full screen, well, that would take away my very interesting links. Now, you can go even further with this, and I'm not gonna talk too much about it, but in the description down below, I have linked to a little snippet of CSS that you can use to actually blur out all of the videos on the YouTube homepage and in the sidebar. So if you don't wanna use full screen, you could try that trick as well. But to move on to item number two here, read articles in reader mode. The fact of the matter is that most websites today are designed with lots of distracting UI elements like pop-ups and sidebars and all kinds of other stuff that is designed to keep you clicking from page to page. But you can get rid of all these elements by using reader mode. Now, Safari on iOS and Chrome for Android both have built-in reader modes, which just isolate all the content and let you see just what you came to read. And on the desktop front, Firefox, Microsoft Edge, and Safari have had them built in for years, and as of this week, Chrome has one as well. You're gonna wanna make sure you are updated to the latest version, Chrome 75 at least, and you're also gonna have to go into the experimental flags section to turn it on. Once you've done that, it is time to move on to item number three, which is to limit the time that you spend on distraction-heavy parts of the internet to a certain window during the day. So instead of making frequent trips to Twitter or Instagram or DeviantArt or whatever you like to go to during the day, restrict it and compress it into maybe just a 1 hour period. And this is actually pretty easy to accomplish. Now, you could just unplug your Ethernet cable or disable your Wi-Fi while you're not using those sites, but you could also get a little more subtle, a little more control over the process by using a website blocking app like Freedom or Cold Turkey. And additionally, item number four here, there are other tools you can use to make social media sites less distracting. For example, I've been using a plugin called Newsfeed Eradicator to destroy my newsfeed on Facebook for a long time. And for tweeting, there are free tweet scheduling apps like Buffer, which will allow you to tweet to your heart's content without actually opening the Twitter app and getting sucked into the feed there. Finally, number five, hide the visual clutter on your desktop. If you're anything like me, you probably have a bookmarks bar, extension icons, and an OS taskbar that are just cluttering up your screen. And all these things can be hidden. If you need them, there are probably keyboard shortcuts to bring them back, or you can hover somewhere, but for the most part, you don't need them, and it would be a lot better to have a distraction-free view of the content that you're trying to read. Now, these are tactical changes, and they're not gonna wean your brain off of its internet-addicted habits on their own, but they will go a long way to helping you do that a lot more easily. Still, remember that the process of changing your brain's most frequently accessed neural pathways is a slow one that's gonna require a lot of discipline at first. So once you've set all these things up, focus more on those positive habits we discussed earlier, reading more books, having more in-depth conversations, and soon, in time, that ability to focus deeply will come back. But while we can change the degree to which the internet affects our brains, one thing that we can't change so easily is just how much our lives are run through it now. We do our banking online, we pay rent online, we store our files up in the cloud. And that means, if you're anything like me, that you have dozens, if not hundreds, of online accounts to manage and to keep secure. That's why I recommend using Dashlane. Instead of using the same password for every account, which is a terrible idea, you can use Dashlane to generate a strong and unique password for every online account you have. All of them are stored in a secure vault that uses very strong encryption, meaning that you are the only person who ever has access to it. And it'll even let you know if any of your passwords are weak, or if they've been compromised in a data breach, or if you're using them across multiple accounts. And when any of those things happens, you can easily change that password to a much stronger one with just the click of a button. You don't even have to log into the website to do it, which is a pretty sweet feature. Plus, Dashlane can instantly log you into websites and autofill long forms, which makes browsing a heck of a lot faster. And with a built-in VPN that keeps your browsing private, dark web monitoring for all of your personal information, and apps for all of your devices, Dashlane is seriously the one tool that you need to keep your online life secure. And as a result, since you're not using multiple tools, it saves you money too. Dashlane has a basic free version that you can get started with, but there's also a premium version that gets you access to all the features I just mentioned. And if you're one of the first 200 people to use the link in the description down below to sign up, you're gonna get a free 30-day trial of that premium subscription and help to support my channel as well. Huge thanks, as always, goes out to Dashlane for sponsoring this video and being a big supporter of my channel, and thank you for watching as well. Hopefully you found something useful in this video that you can use to start building healthier habits, making those positive neurological changes. And if you did enjoy it, consider hitting that like button to support the channel and also subscribing right there to get new videos when they come out. You can also click right around here to get a free copy of my book on how to earn better grades, or click wherever I'm doing jazz hands to watch some more videos here on this channel. Though, if you want to make those positive neurological changes, then maybe you should go read the book.